Welcome to the video ministry of the Cedar Hill Baptist Church in Dillsburg, Pennsylvania, where we stand firmly upon the Word of God. Luke chapter 5. I'm going to read this passage and have a word of prayer and then give a few words of introduction as we get into our message today. Luke chapter number 5, and I'm going to just read starting in verse 1. We'll read down through the first few verses. Luke chapter 5, starting in verse 1, it came to pass that as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret. He saw two ships standing by the lake, but the fishermen were gone out of them. They were washing their nets. He entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the people out of the ship. And when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, "Launch out into the deep. Let down your nets for a draught." Simon answering said unto him, "Master, we have toiled all the night. We have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net." And when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes, and their net brake. And they beckoned unto their partners, which were in the other ship, that they should come and help them. And they came and filled both the ships, so that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." For he was astonished, and all that were with him, at the draught of fishes which were taken. And so was also James and John, the sons of Zebedee, which were partners with Simon. And Jesus said unto Simon, "Fear not, from henceforth thou shalt catch men." And when they had brought their ships to land, they forsook all and followed him. Our dear gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, as we come now to the preaching of the word, Lord, what an opportunity we have to be able to delve into your precious and holy scriptures. Lord, allow me this morning to be your minister, your vessel, used to share and proclaim that which you have laid upon my heart. Lord, may it work in the lives of those that are listening here today. Lord, we have an opportunity. We know that as things have progressed and technology has changed, Lord, the message will not only be heard here today, but Lord, many will hear it via video in weeks to come. And so, Lord, we pray that wherever people may be, as they hear the preaching of the word, may the Holy Spirit work in their hearts and in their lives. Lord, we thank you for this time. Lord, we ask all this in your precious name. Amen. I want to preach this morning on our theme for the year, and our theme is living by faith. I had introduced that theme in January, beginning of the year. I preached it the first Sunday in January. I try to hit that the first Sunday of each month. And since August, that hasn't quite worked out. We've had different missionaries and different people here or speaking and so forth. But I didn't want to lose focus of that. I wanted to get back to it. And so I think the next couple weeks, I'm going to preach on the theme, living by faith. Today, I'm going to a familiar passage and some verse and really some thoughts that you've probably heard me share before. I've preached this message to some degree a number of years ago, and I have referred to this a number of times in a number of my messages, and I hope that it speaks to your heart today. As we come to Luke chapter number 5, we see Jesus calling his apostles, the disciples that are going to follow him, they're going to work with him. And he's just introducing his ministry, he's just getting his ministry started here, and as we come to Luke chapter number 5, we see the time, the day, the moment that Peter, James, and John stop their day job and start following Jesus Christ. This is that moment. This is a pivotal moment, obviously, in their lives. They knew who Jesus was. We had seen them even introduced to Jesus in various means before. Andrew, Peter's brother, had taken and brought him to Jesus and introduced him. We know that they had known and were very much, in some degree, followers of John the Baptist. And so this was not brand new to them, but here's the day that their lives changed. Here's the day that they stopped their day job, fishing, on a regular basis, and began to follow Jesus, and they would become full-time followers of him. It's not the last time they go fishing. Peter, you may remember, after the death and burial of Jesus Christ, said, "Let's go fishing." But after the resurrection of Jesus Christ, boy, things changed, and he got on fire for the Lord, and the Lord said, "Peter, do you love me? feed my sheep. And so Peter's life would dramatically change. We see the book of Acts and how he proclaims the gospel and would live the rest of his life and ultimately die a martyr's death for Jesus Christ. In this particular passage here in Luke chapter 5 this morning, we see Peter changing his job and all in on following Jesus and giving up his time for Jesus. His career is going to change. And think about this for a minute. Peter, from a fishing area, probably no doubt from a fishing family, we don't know all of his background, but seems to be what these men had grown up doing and had been doing. It's what they knew to do. And Peter, as he's coming from a fishing family, he has the boat, he has the nets, he has the tools. That's what he does. That's what he knows how to do. He's a professional fisherman. He supports his family with the catch of fish that he has and what he's able to take to market, what he's able to sell to the market. This is how he supports his family. And so I'm serious about this. Jesus did not introduce Peter to his 401k program, what his salary might be, an expense account if you follow Jesus, right? None of that comes up. In all sincerity and in all honesty, Peter is going to go home probably at the end of this day and tell his wife, guess what? I'm not fishing tomorrow. What? Nope, things changed. We read the end of the story already. Obviously, they caught an incredible number of fish. So many fish, the boat almost broke. So many fish, they had to get James and John to bring their boat out to help harvest the fish. So many that both of the boats almost broke under the load. So extreme amount of fish that day. I'm sure his contact at the fish market must have said, wait, what bait did you use today? You know, what is this? Because he brought in an immense amount of fish that day. No doubt, listen, I believe, think about this, no doubt part of the Lord's plan to help Peter, because Peter's not going to receive a paycheck starting the next day, right? Things are going to change starting the next day. So God gave them a great surplus of fish on this day, which is going to help them sustain their families and move forward as they transition from one career to another, from one job to a ministry. Things are going to change, and so the Lord took place of that. But I want to center, and those of you that have heard me preach this before or highlight this before, you no doubt know where I'm going to go, and that's in verse number 5. Verse number 5, they have been fishing. They haven't caught anything. The Lord tells them in verse 4 to go out in the deep and let down your nets again. Do it again. And Peter, Simon, verse 5, that's Simon. He'll be called Peter later on here. But Simon Peter, answering, said unto him, Master, we have toiled all the night and have taken nothing. Here's Simon Peter again. He knows who Jesus is and is a follower and a believer. Right? This is not a conversion experience. This is a surrender experience. He knows who he is. He's a believer under the preaching of John the Baptist, and he'd been looking for the Messiah, and he believed who he was. He knew he was the Messiah. He knew he was the great teacher. He felt moved and by the power of Jesus' teaching. So none of that's new. And here they have fished all night. They have fished in what Simon Peter would have known to be the ideal time to fish at that place, at that time, in that lake. Over the last couple of weeks, I was in both the Outer Banks and Assateague. And both of those places, the beaches are less commercial. No lifeguards and stuff like that. And so, you know, you're allowed to have your dogs on the beach and you're allowed to fish right there on the beach, right? So, you know, as opposed to like maybe the Jersey Shore where it's very commercialized, this is very open, less rules. And I'm watching these guys fish and I don't really know anything about surf fishing. I've never done surf fishing. And I was looking at it a little bit, and I looked up some things. I Googled some things as I was watching them. And, you know, they have to fish 2 hours, it says, ideally, if you want to catch something, 2 hours before high tide and then 2 hours after high tide. That's the ideal window of when you should be down there. So they may be fishing at 5 in the morning, or they should be fishing at 3 in the afternoon. Depends on the tide. They know what time the tide comes in, so they set up their chairs and their poles and all this stuff, and they're ready to go when it's the right time to go fishing. Simon Peter knew those things. He had grown up fishing. He was a professional. So Simon Peter knew what time to go fishing and where to go fishing. This was the lake. He had lived on this lake. He knew where the fishing spots were. He knew what was running, what was coming in, what they were catching. He knew what the market was. He knew what he wanted to catch. He knew the bait for it. He was a professional fisherman. He fished all night. It was not a good night. He caught nothing. He's on the seashore. He's at the dock. They're washing their nets, the Bible tells us. They're putting things away. He's exhausted. He's about to go home and sleep because he's going to try again tomorrow night, this night, hopefully do better. And in the midst of that, Jesus says to him, listen, the crowds are coming down. They're listening to him. They're pressing down, is listening to Jesus talk. And Jesus turns to Peter, the fisherman, and says, Peter, go back out, put your nets out again. And I don't know about you, but you can kind of see Peter there go, Rabbi, I listen to you. I believe you. I want you to expound the scriptures. I am willing to follow you. No disrespect, Rabbi, but I'm a fisherman. That's what I do. I didn't catch anything. I need to wash up. I need to go home. I need to get some sleep. I need to go fishing again tonight. That would be the mindset, and that's kind of what Peter says there in verse 5. Peter, Master, we toiled all night. We've taken nothing. It's just not the right time. We're not supposed to go fishing now. It's the wrong time of day. It's a time to clean up and get ready and try again tomorrow. And then he says this, nevertheless. Nevertheless. If you've been around, you know I love that word in the Bible. It always comes with a powerful message afterwards. Nevertheless, he says, at thy word, I will let down the net. When Jesus tells you to go fishing, go fishing. Don't question the master. When Jesus is talking to the mass of people that are pressing on him down to the lake, and he turns to Simon Peter, who is discouraged, who is dirty, who is tired, who is washing things down and trying to get things ready, and says, Peter, I want you to go back out and do it again. And there's a moment where Peter goes, I don't know why, but if you tell me to go out, I'm going out. And he takes the nets that he had just washed, and he takes the crew, whoever's with him in the boat, and they go back out. And he has the greatest harvest of fish he's ever had. Have you ever had a nevertheless moment? I think it changes you as a believer in Jesus Christ when that time comes or that opportunity comes or that situation comes where you're like, you know, I don't know that this makes sense on paper. On paper, this isn't adding up. On paper, this isn't going to work. But it's if I know that I know that I know it's what Jesus wants me to do, then I'm willing to do it. If it's what he tells me to do, I'm going to do it. I wrote down a list here of people in the Bible who I think had nevertheless moments, much like Peter did here in Luke chapter 5. How about Daniel? Daniel had it a couple different times. One, when he wouldn't eat the king's meat, but I'm thinking more particular in chapter 6 of the book of Daniel, when they tell Daniel, thou shalt not make any request of anyone except the king. And Daniel goes, oh, that's nice. You know what? It's prayer time. You know? Right up to his room, opening the shutters, as he always did, the same time he always did. to pray for his country and his people and himself. And we know that because we have the words of so many of his prayers. Daniel goes and prays. The king said, don't do that. The new law said, don't do that. Nevertheless, Daniel went up and prayed to God because it was the right thing to do. Noah did that, right? For decades, he worked on a boat. He worked on a boat, not near the ocean, right? He worked on a boat in the middle of some dry land where people mocked him and made fun of him and laughed at him. And he said, you know why I'm building the boat? Because God told me to build a boat. God said it's going to rain and I need the boat. So he kept working on the boat. You would think after decades and decades, discouragement would set in, frustration would set in. I don't know if it did or not. We don't see that. All we see is at the end of the day, he completed the boat. Doesn't make sense building a boat. Not a boat that big. To house animals out here in the yard. Nevertheless, if God says build a boat, I'm going to build the boat. I don't care what people say. Jeremiah did that. We've looked at the story of Jeremiah a number of times. Jeremiah, the prophet, we have from the account of Jeremiah, his own family turned against him. They didn't want to hear the prophet speak. It tells us the people from his own town laid wait or laid siege against him. They were going to try to shut him up. They don't want to hear the message of God. Nevertheless, Jeremiah kept preaching. How about this? Nobody listened to him, really. Jeremiah did not have great results as far as man keeps results. There wasn't a great revival. There wasn't people at the altar getting right with God. There wasn't a cry for repentance. He wrote down the word of God, and it got to the king. And the Bible tells us in the book of Jeremiah, the king took out his penknife, cut it up, and threw it in the fire. Didn't want to hear it. Nevertheless, Jeremiah kept preaching. He kept praying. And cried over his people. Thus the book of Lamentations. How about Jonah? Jonah's an interesting case because Jonah didn't want to do it and put his feet to it, right? I don't want to go to Nineveh. In fact, I'm leaving and going the opposite direction, Jonah said. Jonah had a nevertheless moment. It was in the belly of the fish, right? In the belly, he cried out to God. We have his prayer. It's recorded for us in Scripture. We know exactly what he cried out when he got, and Bible language here, when he got spewed out on dry land, when he survived his trip in the belly of the great fish, and he got spit out on the ground. He didn't try to go to Tarshish again. He hightailed it to Nineveh. I messed up once, you can see Jonah saying. I think I better go. How about Paul? Later in his life, en route to Jerusalem, everybody tried to stop Paul from going to Jerusalem. Paul, they're going to arrest you. Paul, you shouldn't go. They're waiting for you. Paul, don't go. And Paul said, I think God wants me to go to Jerusalem. So he went to Jerusalem. He was in the right place at the right time, even though he was arrested. It was all part of God's perfect will. How about Abraham? The Bible tells us in the book of Hebrews, chapter 11, Abraham moved to a land not knowing where he was headed. We just talked about poor Peter. Peter had to go home and tell his wife, hey, honey, guess what? I changed jobs today. I don't know what I'm getting paid or if I'm getting paid, but I have something more important to do. How about Abraham's conversation? Sarah, we're moving. Where are we going? Don't know. Let's pack up. We'll start heading down the road. Well, how do we know where to stop? Look, God will tell us. It's time to go. And he packed up and moved. I think we need to put some real feet in the shoes of these people in the Bible and look at the real ramifications of the decisions they made. It's one thing for you and I to sit here today and say, Abraham moved to a land God told him to. Okay, go home over dinner and tell your spouse that. Honey, we're moving. Where? I don't know. I just think God wants us to. Well, hold on, you know. We have roots here. We have family here. What are we doing? How about David versus Goliath? That didn't make a lot of sense. The little kid without armor, no war experience, he's the one that's going to go down in the valley and face the seasoned veteran, the mammoth of a soldier. Nevertheless, David went down, picked up the smooth stones, and slew the giant. They don't all turn out like that, though. How about John the Baptist? John the Baptist had a terrific ministry. I mean, people repented, people listened, the crowds were there. He was paving the way for the Messiah. He introduced the Messiah. He had the opportunity to baptize Jesus Christ. And then just about that time, all of his followers followed Jesus, which was what he was intending to do, right? That was his ministry, pave the way for the Messiah. But all of a sudden, everybody that was with him left and followed him. John the Baptist gets arrested. He's sitting in jail. If you remember, he sends some of his disciples back to Jesus and said, I'm just sitting in jail here. You are the one, right? Like, I did everything I'm supposed to do, but I'm sitting in jail. God's like, that's right where I want you. Doesn't seem like the coziest of arrangements, but that's where I want you. You've finished your course. You've kept the faith. You've done the work that I've asked you to do, John the Baptist. Jesus goes on to tell the followers at that time, there is none greater born to women. And I have to say it, right? Jesus mentioned that people were only born to women, for those that don't know that anymore in our culture. But born to women meant everybody. Everybody, right? There is none greater than John the Baptist. Wow, that's a vote of confidence. Wouldn't you want that on your gravestone? Jesus said, you've done a great job. Well done. Nehemiah continued his work even when everyone was against him. I mean, I'm not going to get into the whole book of Nehemiah, but just one group after another trying to stop the work, trying to slow down the work, lie about him, trick him. Nevertheless, Nehemiah completed the wall in record time because it's the job God gave him to do. We could say the same about the three Hebrew children. Everybody kneeled down. They stayed standing. They stuck out. Nevertheless, we're not bowing down to that altar. We're not bowing down to that idol. We're not bowing down to that statue. We're not. But everybody is. No, we're not. It could cost you. You'll go in the fiery furnace. Doesn't matter. The king says, the law says, and everyone else says, bow. Nevertheless, they didn't. So how do I apply this to my life? I wrote down a couple of things, maybe applicable to folks, or my marriage hasn't worked out the way I planned. Hasn't worked out the way I thought it would. Nevertheless, I will trust him with my future. My health is not improving like I prayed. Nevertheless, I will serve him with the time and the strength he gives me. I find myself all alone at this stage of my life. Nevertheless, Jesus said, I will never leave thee, nor forsake thee. My ministry, the things I used to do for the Lord, I can't do anymore. I can't sing anymore. Can't preach anymore. Can't leave my class anymore. Can't play the piano anymore. Nevertheless, I'll do what I know the Lord wants me to do today. I've been badly hurt, deeply offended. Nevertheless, God brings healing He has forgiven me, and I will forgive them. My life has not turned out like I hoped. I had big dreams. It hadn't turned out like I hoped. Nevertheless, my future is secure and prepared by him. I'm in the midst of crisis. Nevertheless, I know that everything that comes to me must first pass through my Father's hands. Have you had a nevertheless moment? I hope you have. Hope you've seen it. I've given this example before, and my dear mother is here today, but I saw mom and dad sell everything. To go into the Lord's work. Sell the house, move away from family, leave their jobs, leave their careers, do it all. Why? To serve him. What kind of impact does that have on the child in your home? I think there's a point where we go, I don't know if I can do that when my kids are at home. I had somebody tell me that years ago. They told me, this was 18, 19 years ago. Wes, I think the Lord's called me into full-time Christian work, but my kids are home, and so maybe after they're grown, then I'll go serve him. Do you think they ever did? I know they didn't. How about we go serve the Lord now and let our kids see where our priorities are? 19 years ago, Desi and I came to a little Baptist church in Dillsburg. 22 people. 22 members. I think there was 30-some people my first Sunday. 22 members. I told Des, should I leave my job? I was in the middle of a record year. All those big expectations they gave you, I was blowing them out of the water. And at the end of the year, I would get a nice trophy and a nice bonus and all that stuff and tell my boss, what? I quit. What? Why? Why? You got the best store. You're in the best possible position. I said, I know. Everything was set up to be successful down the road. And the store was successful down the road. You leave to go where? Dillsburg. And everybody I meet says, where? What? Where's Dillsburg? I'm not joking, but much like Peter, you know, there was no 401k or pension plan. I have friends that are retiring early now with nice pensions and nice, all that, they have all that stuff. Great. I wouldn't trade where I am for anywhere in the world because you want to be in the middle of God's will. And Peter and John got that day, right? They forsook all and they followed him. They left the family business, not an easy thing to do. Left their jobs to follow Jesus, not for the pay, not for the popularity. All of them would end up dying martyrs. I think we'd agree none of them ever regretted that decision. The end of their life, when they gave their life for the cause of Christ, did they regret it? No, I don't think they were wishing they were fishing right then. Luke 22, I saved the most important one for last. Luke 22. We have a godly example of this very thing. Luke 22, starting in verse 39. Luke 22, verse 39, he came out, went as he went to the Mount of Olives. His disciples followed with him. We're talking about Jesus Christ. This is just before the crucifixion. And when he was at the place, he had a place to pray. Notice that? Can I stop there for a moment? That's so important. Daniel had a place to pray. His enemies knew where to find him. He would be at that window praying. He always prayed right there. Jesus had a place to pray. His enemy knew where to find him. Judas Iscariot said, took the guards and said, let's go. I know where he is. Where is he? He's praying. He's always praying here. I think that's important. If someone wanted to find your place to pray or my place to pray, would they know where it is? When he was at the place, he said unto them, pray that ye enter not into temptation. Verse 41, he was withdrawn from them about a stone's cast. He kneeled down and he prayed, saying, Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. I've said before, this is the verse that jumped out at me. This is the verse that I think just the Lord used to just transform my soul in this particular subject. Here's Jesus Christ in the garden just before the crucifixion. He has his disciples. They've left the Last Supper. They're at the Mount of Olives. He's about to be arrested. And Jesus is praying, and we can see it's one of those glimpses we have of his humanity and his divine nature intersecting here for a moment. Jesus Christ is there praying, Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. That's the humanity of Christ right there, right? He understands this crucifixion is a horrible death. And then taking the weight of all the sin of all of eternity upon my shoulders is more than I think I can bear. Let's come up with another plan. If it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Let's change this plan. That's the human side of him. Because he was all human, simultaneously all God. We can't comprehend that in our human mind, but Jesus did it as only God can. If it be possible, let this cup pass. Nevertheless, not my will. Thine be done. Satan had tried throughout the life of Christ to stop the plan of redemption from being fulfilled. Satan had tried. There had been the edict passed down by Herod to kill all the babies at that time in Bethlehem. Remember that? Jesus and his parents, they had to flee for their lives for a period. So he tried to kill all the babies in that particular part of Israel at that time. Satan had tried. Satan, we see the temptation later on of Christ when he's been fasting, he's been in the wilderness for the 40 days, and then Satan comes and he tempts him. I think it's important to put that into some context. You will hear, if you come to our series on Wednesdays, you'll hear Jim Berg give such a clear picture of that. But here's Jesus Christ being tempted one-on-one with Satan himself. Satan is not omnipresent and all-powerful. Those are God's attributes, not Satan's. Satan can't be everywhere at one time. There's 7 billion people, last I looked. I don't know that Satan has time for me. Oh, he has demons that do the work, don't get me wrong. He has his angels that do the work. My flesh is bad enough. But Jesus Christ had Satan one-on-one tempting him when he was physically weak. Satan had tried to stop this whole thing from taking place. And don't you think for just a moment, as Jesus is in the garden and he begins to pray and the sweat is running down his brow and the blood is coming forth. It says he sweat, as it were, drops of blood. And Satan's listening. Do you think he's listening? I think he's listening to what Jesus is praying. Jesus says, Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass. And Satan must have gone, oh, goody. All right, here we go. We can stop this. And then Jesus said, nevertheless. I think the battle was won right there. I think Satan knew he was defeated right there. Nevertheless, thy will be done. And he went through the mock trial. And he went to the cross of Calvary to die for you and me and to carry the sins of mankind upon his shoulders. Satan could not stop it. Jesus, I think, sets the perfect example. What does it mean to come to a point in our lives where we're like, nevertheless, I'm serving him. Nevertheless, I'm living for him. Nevertheless, I'm believing him. I'm trusting him. I want to talk about this tonight in our evening service, but how about this? Jesus said, I will come again and receive you unto myself. The majority of culture does not think Jesus is coming again. Too many religious people don't think Jesus is coming again. How about we at least say, things are bad out there. They're not so great in my family. They're not so great in my life. They're not so great in my health. And they're chaos in the world. Nevertheless, I am looking up because he's coming again. He said it. I believe it. I'm not changing it. I'm not second guessing it. I'm not coming up with a new plan or a new equation or a new theme. No, no, no. Jesus said he's coming again, and I'm looking for him to come again. I don't care what the world says. I don't care what people who have 18 theology degrees say. Jesus said, be ready. As a thief in the night, I'll come. Have your lamps trimmed and burning. Be prepared. No man knows when. God knows when. I'm coming. Be ready. If there's one thing that I have tried, and if you've heard me say this, I think a number of times this year, I hope the congregation of Cedar Hill Baptist Church is not surprised when the trumpet blows. We are expecting it and ready for it and excited, waiting for the trumpet to blow. We have work to do here, folks. We have plenty to do here. We don't give up. We're not going to go sit on the mountaintop and sing Kumbaya, right? We're not. All right, we have work to do. And I'm going to unveil that in our Sunday night service next week in the business meeting. There's things coming. We have plans. We have things to do. We're working until Jesus comes. We don't know when that is. He knows when that is. But I'm expecting the trumpet to blow at any time. And I would think we would agree the events over the last week to 10 days tell us it is right around the corner. Right around the corner. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the time we've had today. Lord, I pray that in the time we have, that we have had here in the Word, Lord, may we be more committed than ever to live by faith. Live by faith saying, Lord, I don't know if it makes sense, but you've said it and I'm going to do it. I'm going to believe it. I'm going to follow it. I'm going to trust it. I don't care what the world says. I don't care what other people say. You said it. Therefore, it is. Lord, may we have that nevertheless commitment in our lives. Lord, may we be looking for the soon coming return of Jesus Christ. The world was in darkness and caught off guard the first time he came. Lord, too many are going to be in darkness and caught off guard the second time you come. Lord, may we be watching and waiting. Lord, I pray if there's one here today that does not know you as Savior, Lord, may today be their day of salvation. May they put their faith and trust in you. Lord, I think that first nevertheless moment may very well be our day of salvation. I have questions. I'm not sure. I don't know. I don't know what to think. But Jesus is working in my life, and I'm going to trust him with my eternity. Lord, there's a nevertheless moment that will change us for all of eternity. Lord, I hope and pray if there's one here today that doesn't know you as Savior, Lord, may they come. May they come take my hand and say, Pastor, I'd like to know what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ. You can come at the end of the service. You can come meet me at the door, whatever. But say, I want to know what it means to be a Christian.
Lord, I pray that those of us that are here today, Lord, may we be committed more than ever to follow you no matter what people say, no matter what culture says, no matter what society says. May we have that nevertheless theme in our hearts. We thank you. We ask all this in your precious name. Amen.